Greetings, radio people. Welcome to my shack. I wanted to do a quick video to try and explain to you why I think this, the TS-890, is the bee's knees. I'm going to go through a few of the features of the radio that I think make it really, really shine, and why I think it's one of the best rigs I've ever owned. Let's get on with it. So most importantly first, how does it look? So, what's the look and feel of this rig compared to others? Well, the screen is very big to start with. There's a lot of good information on there, and for me the band scope is one of the most important features of the modern radios. This one has lots and lots of configuration options that allows you to set it up just as you like it, and that for me I like very much. I also very much like the audio indicator that I've got up here, so if I were to be tuning into a CW signal, or there's a carrier there, I can see very clearly when I've tuned that in correctly. The radio is very, very solidly constructed. I like very much the feel of the controls. All of these knobs feel very, very solid and well made, and the layout of the radio is excellent. And one of the features that I like very much is the fact that there are three controls on the front panel that I can customize myself. There's PFA here, PFB and PFC, and the menu system in the radio allows you to configure those to do specific tasks that you're interested in. The other thing to mention on this rig is that the menu structure, to me, whilst it's complicated, like every modern rig is complicated, there are many, many configuration options and different items you can set. For me, the menu is extremely intuitively constructed. I can find things in the menu structure here very easily, and very, very rarely do I have to consult the manual. So that's another great plus for me. The other thing that Kenwood have done is they've given you a whole bunch of options on the spectrum scope, so you can have a pretty big waterfall along with the real-time scope that you can see here now. You can have just the scope, which is my preference, I think, for CW, certainly. Or you can fiddle around with the options in here as well. So there's quite a few things you can do. The other thing you might notice, those of you playing along at home, there's a white line on my radio just where I'm tuning to now. If you see, there's a white line on the spectrum scope. You can actually add your favourite frequencies in. So that particular frequency is actually the 80 meter fists frequency, which is where I often like to tune the radio or keep an eye on for people calling CQ on that particular frequency. So I've been able to add an extra line onto the band scope so that I know that that's one of my favorite frequencies. That's a really, really neat feature. One of the things I wanted to mention before I go any further is the Sherwood engineering league tables for the radios. Now, I don't believe that I'm going to be able to tell the difference between the rig that sits at number one in the table and the rig that sits in number eight at the table. This one, I think, is currently at seven. I've got a very modest antenna system here. I'm in a suburban environment, which is very noisy, and I don't believe that I'm ever going to be able to hear something on the top of the range, the highest rated rig, compared to this one, which is rated at 7. I don't believe that choosing a radio because it's the top of that list is that critical. As long as we're in the top 20, I don't think you're going to notice a difference between the receiver performances. That's a personal view, but it's just what I think. So what I wanted to try and do is explain to you how I've got the band scope set up, and to show you a little bit about what the options are. I'm currently in fixed mode. There are three different modes, but fixed mode is the one we'll talk about first. And in fixed mode, it kind of does what it says on the tin, in that the range that you've got available, so the bottom end and the top end of the band scope, and in this example we're going from 3.5 to 3.6 megahertz, that's fixed. So if I tune past the end of the current limits of the band scope, nothing happens. The cursors that show me where my RX and TX VFOs are disappear off the top, and I get a little arrow to show me that I'm off the top of the scale. These ranges are configurable by band. You press and hold the F3 button, and you'll see that there are three different sets of numbers here. So I can set the upper and the lower limit of each of the three ranges for each band. So I've got 3.5 to 3.6, 3.6 to 3.7, and 3.5 to 3.8, which is the full band in the UK. So if you were to go and select the upper range, the 3.8, I could basically tune this using a control on the front of the radio and set that to whatever I want it to be. So these ranges are very easily configurable, and it's something you can set up the way that you want it to be. There are two other modes available on the rig. There's center mode, which is exactly what it says. So when it's in center mode, your receive frequency is always in the middle. So as you tune, you effectively tune the signals up and down along the bottom, so that the band scope itself is moving around, but the center piece always stays the same. The other mode is auto scroll, and in auto scroll, this will change, but it only changes once you get towards the edge. So as I tune up, you'll notice that as soon as I get near the end here, the band scope at the bottom will change. So the band scope has scrolled down and repositioned my cursor to the center. So that's auto scroll mode. So you pay your money, you take your choice, you pick the one that you particularly like. As I say, I particularly like fixed mode. And for me, having it so I can configure the range just to see the CW part of the band, or just to see the digital mode part of the band, or just to see the SSB part of the band, is exactly how I like to set it up. And one of the things that I don't want to show you in great detail, but just give you a flavour of, is I use macros to control my rig quite a lot. And this radio covers 60 metres, and there's no button on the front because it's not a standard band that's offered around the world. So I've got a single macro to configure that, and I just wanted to show it to you. So a single mouse click on my logging software, which happens to be Logger 32, has put the radio into 5.262, that's a CW frequency. It's set the bandwidth to how I want it for this rig. It's set the ranges up how I want it. And it's configured all of the different things that I want to configure from the radio when I put it into 60 meters. Ditto, if I want to put the radio in 30 metres, a single button click in my logging software puts me there. It's setting up an awful lot of things that you can't perhaps see in so much from the screen, but it allows me to put the radio into exactly the configuration I want. And with the Kenwood rig, the command set for the cat control or the macros that you can write is very, very intuitive. If you look at an Icom, it's very, very complicated and lots of hex numbers that confuse me immensely, whereas the Kenwood and also the Yaesu have got a very simple, intuitive command set. So I find writing macros for this radio very, very easy, and it's something I do an awful lot of that I will focus on in a little bit. One of the other features I really wanted to show you was, I mentioned it at the beginning, there are three keys on this front of this rig. There's PFA, PFB and PFC, which are probably out of shot, but there's three of these. There's an A, B and C key that you can configure to do whatever you want. Now, one of the things that tends to be a bit tricky, especially on Icom radios, is just transmitting a carrier. If you want to tune your external ATU or fiddle with your amplifier, or generally set things up externally, you need to put out a 5 to 10 watt RF carrier and do that on each band that you're doing. Now, if I go to menu, option 0, which is basic configuration, and then if I scroll down here and look at options 15, 16 and 17, those are the assignments of these three keys that I mentioned. Now, there's a huge long list that you can choose from that goes all the way. It's ordered alphabetically, so you can generally find what you're looking for. But I've got my PFA set to TX Tune 1. I've got PFB set to capture, that does a screen capture, and then I've got PF3 set to safe removal of a USB flash drive. So if you put a memory stick in the USB slot, you just hit PFC and it makes it safe to remove it. So with PFA set to TX Tune, when I'm in a whatever band I'm in, if we find a blank space, if I press the PFA key, the radio goes into transmit and it transmits a small RF carrier for me. What could be simpler? PFB, as I've mentioned, I'm just going to press it now. You'll see that the memory, internal memory indicator flashes. I'm going to do that again. So that's the radio taking a screen capture of what's on the screen right now. And it's storing it in internal memory. So one of the things that you can then do is if you press menu and you go to the USB file menu, You can say copy files to PC via USB cable if you press select to that. And in this case, I'm going to want to select the screen capture files that we just took. So the screen capture files, I'm going to put the tick box in there, then press the OK button. And it now says it's transferring those files to my PC. And what it's done is on the PC, it's as if I've just connected a USB drive. If I put a USB drive into the USB socket on my PC, a box pops up and says, what do you want me to do with this? Do you want to open an Explorer to view the files? Do you want to copy them? Do you want to do this? Do you want to do the other? And it's exactly what's just happened on my PC. So the radio has configured itself as a USB drive, it's connected itself to the PC, and I can now copy off those files that I just created. I could do the same if I want to save the configuration of the radio. So all of the menu settings, all of the configurable items, you save it to a file, copy it straight to your PC, and in my case I then copy it to my OneDrive, which means that it's backed up in the cloud. In case anything ever happens to my radio and I need to reset it, I can just go and fetch the configuration file, load it back in. What could be simpler? That is a really, really, really neat feature that I like very, very much indeed. One of the other simple things I wanted to show you was that you can configure the power output by band. Now, for me, I have an Expert 1.3K FA amplifier, and to get the UK legal limit out of that amplifier, I need to drive it with different levels on different bands. So you'll notice there's a feature here that says max PO, which is currently off. If I press that, it now says max PO 8 watts, which means that I've set the maximum power on this particular band, 30 meters, to be 8 watts. If we press and hold this, it brings up a table. And what you can see is that each band that the radio covers is listed along the top, and you'll note that it includes 4 meters and it includes 60 meters. You've got the maximum power limit, and in this case it's for CW, is listed along here, and the maximum tune power. Earlier on I showed you using the PFA key to produce a carrier. This value here is the number of watts that it puts out for that carrier. Now, the one thing to notice is that you've got a different set of numbers for SSB, CW, FSK, PSK, AM, FM, and data. So there are 5 different sets of power output configuration that you can set up depending on mode and band. And that is really, really useful. One thing to mention though is that when you press the max power output button, currently it's set on to 8 watts, and you'll see it's active because it's yellow at the top there. If I press that, it now says TX power limit is turned off. That's absolutely not true. It's not turned off until I press OK. A lot of people have done that, pressed the escape key or done whatever, and said, OK, I've turned off maximum power. Well, you haven't. You have to press that, and then you have to go OK. And now it's switched off. Now, some of the purists will no doubt frown at this, but I think the CW decode feature of this radio is absolutely fantastic. My CW is not that brilliant. I've challenged myself this year to try and improve it, and actually I've just passed a RSGB Morse competency test, so perhaps it's not as bad as I thought it was. There's a couple of features on this radio which I think are brilliant. Now, the CW tune feature I found on the Icoms isn't very good, but if I'm off frequency here, if I press the CWT button, it does a very good job of tuning in the signal, and that's a really neat feature. I've also demonstrated at the beginning the CW decode capability. It seems to be very, very good. It's not brilliant by any means. It's never going to be perfect, but it does help a little bit if you're struggling with CW. But one of the things that I find fabulous in this rig is that it also allows me to send CW. Now, there's a USB keyboard connected to this radio. It's just a cheap Amazon something or other. It's a wireless keyboard. It's connected to the USB socket here, and I can use that as a CW keyboard if I want to. The other thing that the radio will do for me, if I tune to a bit of blank space, I'm not going to transmit anyway, but if you look down here, now, that allows me to also practice my sending and check my spacing. You'll see that the space between the X and the KN that I sent wasn't long enough, so it means that my timing wasn't perfect. that's better. Now, but it allows me to check the timing and spacing and everything else of my Sent CW, and to me that's invaluable. There's very, very few other means that I can do that using the radio. Now, to me, this feature's fantastic. I absolutely love it. So if we clear everything here now, and if I do a quick demo with the CW keyboard. I'll just press return now. Brilliant, isn't it? So I can't finish the video without doing something on 4 meters. Now, this radio includes 70 megahertz by default, and I do a little bit of meteor scatter on that band. As I mentioned earlier, I tend to use macros to set my radio up, and the meteor scatter config is no exception. So I'm just going to click the appropriate button in Logger 32. So that's set up in split mode now for 6 meter operation, 50.280. I tend to put it into split so that I transmit on 280 and listen on perhaps 285, and I'll call CQ285. And then similarly for 4 meters. So that radio is now set up and configured for the 4 meter band. Again, 70.280 for meteor scatter. The ability to write macros to me simplifies things immensely. It means I can get the configuration exactly how I want it every time. But the 4 meters works very well on this rig. I've used it in some of the UKAC tests, and I've done some meteor scatter with it as well. Works very, very well indeed. I hope this video has been of some use to you. There's tons more that I haven't covered, but I'm delighted with my 890, and I hope if you get one, you will be too.